Was my little sort of space where I generated ideas. You know, it was a simple setup, one or two synthesizers. This was about maybe one year and a half ago. And then, a simple setup, generating an idea from one or two pieces of hardware equipment, you know, using a laptop basically as a tape recorder. And getting a riff, getting a hook, getting something tangible, something that I could really develop and sketch out and work with, and not really moving on from that point until I had something good, you know. And then, this room sort of developed, I guess, into what you see around you. But I guess the system still is in place of, you know, starting off with a hook, with a riff. And in this case, my system really is, it usually starts off with a sequencer, the sec, or else a polyphonic synthesizer, some chords. And they're my two starting points, are with the music, you know, with the riff. I used to go through a stage where I'd start with beats, with a drum loop or that, but I have a kick drum filtered right down, all the high end out of it, merely there as a pulse now. And then when I want to add percussion, it's totally just for padding and just to fill out space pretty much. So my approach now is really all about the hook, and it has been for quite a while. A lot of the gear in here, like, it was a list nearly from college that I had in my head, you know, of like, you know, I wanted my 808, 909, wanted a red SH-101, I've got a grey one in there and I want a blue one too. I will eventually get that at some point. My drum machines, I wanted, you know, the staples, I wanted the Lynn drum, because I was using all the samples for so many years, you know, I was loading them into Ultra Beat and Logic, you know, on various different samplers. It's become, you know, partially a collection, but it's a totally functional collection. You know, it's not like a load of cars that's in the garage. Everything gets used here, everything gets serviced here. You know, everything's well looked after, everything works. It's something that I love, and, you know, even getting into the, you know, the maintenance and the tech side of it is something that, you know, is naturally sort of happening through curiosity and, I guess, love for the instruments. I know it might seem like a lot to some people, but when you choose to write every single day, you know, how many pens do you have in your office or how much paper do you have? It's irrelevant, because all you have to do is write. And once the material's there, all I have to do is write. That's all that matters. So, you know, it just becomes a palette for me, what you see around me, and I just have to write, you know. With Ableton from there, yeah, I tend to write some MIDI in there, record my MIDI in there, or with the sequencer, or in some cases I'll play it on the instrument, record it in loopback. And from that point on, different things have a different signal chain in here. For instance, the two drum machines, the 808, the 909, they run into Universal Audio here, 6176. And the same with the 808 and the 909, they have dedicated inputs, you know, with the 610, preamp, and then into the 76 as well. So mild compression on the drums, but it's more about color boosts and really keeping an eye on my gain levels, my gain structure from the get-go. You know, from the very initial stages, I want my levels to be where they need to be. And for the drums, that's where I go. Then for bass lines, the Devilfish 303, or else the Model D, they'll go into the LA610s. And it's, you know, it's the Teletrons, it's the limiter that we all love on bass. And again, same 610 preamp. And then I guess sort of moving around some of the, like the stereo, the Prophet 12 and the OB and that, I used the preamps here on the Neves, and everything gets a respectable preamp at some stage, whether it's I'm swapping and changing some of this, but I've 8 pre's there as well on the desk. So from there, back in through my Apogee converters and into the DAW, and then the processing stage from there in the box is limited enough because I'll do work on my arrangement after everything's tracked and recorded, and then it goes to the desk and everything's mixed there. And if there's going to be EQ or compression, I try and leave that to that stage. You know, there's some sidechain compression and obviously some nasty low frequencies and cut out here and there, but it's, you know, it's a pretty sort of clean chain mix wise on like that to this stage. The converters in here are the Apogee converters, and I started using them years ago, many years ago, and I used a smaller one, a Duet, and that sort of, I guess, locked me into almost the brand. But it was the conversion, and I was convinced and sold this by my principal in sound engineering college. The conversion on the Apogee is some of the best. I moved around. I have an Antelope card in there as well, and I used that for touring. But the Apogee converters for me are the cleanest, you know, the most honest. And I don't want color, loads of color on mine too much, or pushing and pulling stuff, only subtracting with EQ. So I really wanted my source sound to be really good. Therefore, I wanted a really clean, honest conversion with the converters. I know what a studio sounds like and what it should look like and sound like. But if you know a space, you know, and you sort of know its habits and how certain stuff sounds in it, and I have 1, 2, 3 sets of monitors, but the barefoots have 4 different settings on them, so I can go through them. So there's 1, 2, 3 sets of monitors, 2 sets of headphones, then I can go downstairs, I can listen to it on my, you know, TV on the soundbar and that. I can jump from the car, I can listen to it there, I can listen to it on my little Bose headphones for the airplane, on my laptop. I have gone through every different process, you know, before it's finished. And in most cases, you know, 75%, 80% of the cases, it goes off to a mastering engineer anyway, you know, should there be any anomalies there that I can't find. And once you get something sounding good on little shitty speakers or on the NS10 settings, you know, they're going to translate something really well to a good set and a good set of monitors. And that's it. Once you get your stuff, once your gain structure's in place, once you keep an eye on a frequency spectrum as well, you know, and just using your ears, you know, really, really tuning in and using them and concentrating on what you're hearing and focusing on what you're hearing, that should be enough to eliminate, you know, the need to, you know, to acoustically fit out every room. Most people in the world live in rented accommodation these days, and you can't go, you know, hammering stuff up. You know, that's the truth, right? So, learn to work at lower levels and, you know, get comfortable with the space that you're working in, and, you know, a few different reference monitors, and I think that's a really good start. Works for me.